The views and opinions expressed in the following program do not necessarily reflect the policies and position of this network.
Everyone, it's Tuesday, April 9 here in Manila. I'm Karen Davila giving you the head start for the day. Our guests for Hot Coffee today, it's an honor to have them back on Head Start. We have Philippine Ambassador to the United States, Jose Manuel Romualdez, as we turn our focus to the upcoming trilateral summit between the United States, the Philippines, and Japan. And later on, we have Commodore Jay Tarniella of the Philippine Coast Guard. He'll be joining us for our second Hot Coffee. But first, the headlines. Today's big stories: China slams the upcoming trilateral summit between the U.S., Philippines, and Japan. Vice President Sara Duterte still mum on the West Philippine issue. And a deadlock in the talks for a ceasefire in Gaza, with Israel setting a date for its invasion of Rafah. China taking a swipe at the upcoming trilateral summit of the United States, the Philippines, and Japan. Beijing's foreign ministry says China is against any circles that threaten regional peace and stability.
We oppose relevant countries cobbling together exclusionary small circles and creating bloc confrontations. Japan in particular should learn from the lessons of history and be cautious in its words and deeds in the field of military security. Any cooperation conducted by any countries should be conducive to regional peace and stability.
Beijing also singled out Washington, saying it firmly opposes the U.S. attempt to deploy a medium-range missile system in the Asia-Pacific region.
We have no interest in competing with any country on military power. China firmly opposes the U.S.'s practice of deploying medium-range missiles in the Asia-Pacific region and strengthening forward deployments at China's doorstep to seek unilateral military advantages. We urge the United States to earnestly respect the security concerns of other countries and stop undermining regional peace and stability.
Meanwhile, President Marcos Jr. hopes maritime tensions with China will be tempered after Manila's weekend naval drills with three of its allies. Bianca Dava reports.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. expressed hope that Chinese aggression in the West Philippine Sea would be avoided following the first ever multilateral maritime cooperative activity in the West Philippine Sea on Sunday. The exercises involved the armed forces of the Philippines, BRP Gregorio del Pilar, BRP Antonio Luna, and BRP Valentin Diaz, with the naval and air assets of the United States Indo-Pacific Command, Australian Defense Force, and Japan's Self-Defense Forces. The president also gave the assurance that Philippine officials continue to talk to their Chinese counterparts so that tension in the region would no longer escalate.
We still continue to talk at the ministerial level, at the sub-ministerial level, at the people-to-people level. Lahat ng maaari natin gawin, ginagawa natin para kausap ang Chinese leadership, ang Beijing, makausap sila na natin masyadong papainitin pa.
The Department of National Defense stressed the MMCA was a show of unity among the four countries rather than a show of force against China, something also undertaken by other nations.
The objective was to strengthen our cooperative activities with our partners, essentially our ally, the U.S., in this instance, Japan and Australia. And we wanted to strengthen our regional and international cooperation with them and, of course, enhance our interoperability. What we wanted to do here is to uphold the freedom of navigation and overflight. You know? And we wanted to stress in the MCA the respect for our maritime rights under international law, namely UNCLOS.
Japan's defense minister says the South China Sea issue is directly related to peace and stability. He adds, Japan opposes any unilateral changes to the status quo and any actions that increase maritime tensions. For U.S. Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin, Washington's activities with its allies underscore their shared commitment to ensure all countries are free to fly, sail, and operate wherever international law allows. Communication exercises, division tactics, and anti-submarine warfare drills were conducted during the activity.
Yung anti-submarine warfare drill is actually just sensing kung may mga presence na mga underwater vessels. May mga sensors tayo.
AFP Chief of Staff General Romeo Bronner Jr. confirmed two People's Liberation Army Navy vessels were seen some 6 nautical miles away from the exercise area.
We noticed the presence of two PLA Navy ships, no? In the distance. Pero wala naman pong ginawa itong mga Navy ships na ito para i-block or hadlangan yung ginagawa nating mga exercises. So tuloy-tuloy naman, naging successful yung ating multinational maritime cooperative activity. We were able to achieve all the objectives that we have set forth.
I can only assume that they are also performing freedom of navigation on their own terms. But I have no information as to that if they were moving, or I have no information also as to what they were doing there in the area.
China earlier said its PLA Southern Theater Command also organized naval and air combat patrols in the South China Sea the same day that the MMCA was conducted. But Bronner said they have not seen any Chinese activities in the area.
Narinig natin na yung China daw ay magsasagawa rin ng kanilang combat patrols, no? Pero sa nakita nating pag-monitor dun sa area, wala naman pong ganung nangyari, no? Wala naman ginawang mga combat patrol or mga exercises.
Although future MCAs are yet to be scheduled, the Defense Department said the Philippines is ready and open to conduct such activities with its allies, partners, and like-minded nations. Bianca Dava, ABS-CBN News.
All right, joining us now on Hot Copy, we have with us Philippine Ambassador to the United States, Jose Manuel Romualdez. Ambassador Romualdez, good morning to you, sir.
Good morning, Karen. Thank you very much for inviting me.
All right. With the upcoming historical trilateral summit this April 11 and 12 in the United States, China had already issued a statement and said that it opposes relevant countries cobbling together in what it described, Ambassador, as exclusionary small circles, creating bloc confrontations. Are we doing that?
Definitely not. The president has made it very clear from the very beginning that he would like to have a multilateral approach to any situation that we are facing right now in the West Philippine Sea or the South China Sea, whatever you want to call it. The bottom line is that we are getting together with many of our friends and allies who believe in the same rule of law, the international waters that is obviously is important for any country, like-minded countries that are now joining us in the fact that we have the arbitration case that was decided in favor of the Philippines. That's all we're doing here, a multilateral approach. We are not doing anything that is outside of the ordinary that we feel is important for us. And again, I'd like to emphasize the president would like to see a multilateral approach into trying to solve the situation in the West Philippine Sea.
Okay. Now, the president will be visiting the United States this coming April 10, and this is his fourth U.S. visit. Within that visit is the trilateral summit. How historical is this? Is this the first of its kind?
Yes, definitely. This is the first time that an invitation like this was sent out to both Japan and the Philippines by the White House. It is something that I think is not only historical, but momentous in one sense, because we are this trilateral meeting is not only encompasses the defense of the area, or the Indo-Pacific region, but also the cooperation, that the economic cooperation that we're putting together with both Japan and the United States. This is definitely going to be not only good for the Philippines, but good for the Indo-Pacific region. This will actually define the future of what our area will be like in the future.
Okay. Now, what are the expectations? When the president arrives in the U.S. on April 10, he'll first have a bilateral meeting with U.S. President Joe Biden. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And then the
meeting will take place. President Biden has invited President Marcos for a meeting with him at the White House on April 11. And shortly after that, the Prime Minister of Japan will be joining them in a trilateral summit meeting.
Okay. So the trilateral summit meeting happens after the bilateral meeting. And then Yes. Is there another trilateral meeting with cabinet officials coming from the Philippines?
Yes, actually, there will be simultaneously, almost on the same day and then perhaps the next day, we will have trilateral meetings between our Secretary of National Defense, the Department of Defense of the United States, and also the Ministry of Defense of Japan. Together with that, we will also have Secretary of State and the Secretary of Foreign Affairs will also have a meeting at the same time. And then on the economic side, we will have the Department of Trade Secretary, and the Commerce Secretary will also have a meeting separately to discuss all the aspects of our relationship with both Japan and the United States.
Yeah. So this trilateral meeting doesn't only or solely focus on the issues of the West Philippine Sea, or is that the main focus?
No, it is really not. It's very unfortunate that China looks at this in that is directed towards them. We are really the trilateral meeting is mainly a cooperation of three countries that believe that it is in their interest that we have this very strong cooperation. Not necessarily on defense alone, but again, the economic cooperation. And there are many aspects of the economic cooperation that we have, like the clean energy, infrastructure, digital, cyberspace. All of these things are part and parcel of what we see as important for the three countries. And in fact, there are other countries that most likely will be joining in the future.
Now, Ambassador, the president is also being criticized for actually escalating tensions with China. Number one, I want to ask you, the fact that he's visiting the United States for the fourth time, some critics have said, shouldn't the president actually meet with ASEAN leaders, our neighbors, instead of always leaning towards the United States when it comes to our maritime issues in the West Philippine Sea?
Well, again, that is absolutely not true. The fact is, President Marcos has reached out to many of our ASEAN neighbors, specifically Vietnam, Indonesia, even Malaysia, and even Brunei. He has met with all the other presidents. The same, we have overlapping claims in the same area, but we are talking to them, meaning the president himself has indicated that he would like to see some cooperation with these other countries. The United States is an old ally of the Philippines, and there's no question about it. I mean, nobody can question the fact that we have been with the United States for a very long time. This is a country that feels that if they can help us, especially since it also jibes with their own national interests, then it is only natural for us to have this type of defense strategy with the United States. The United States has also offered on many occasions, not only to President Marcos, but to other presidents as well in the past, that we would like to have a stronger relationship. Remember, the Visiting Forces Agreement was signed during the time of 1993, 94. And then there was the EDCA, which was signed during the time of the late President Noynoy Aquino. So all of this is part and parcel of what President Marcos is just simply continuing this relationship that we have with the United States. And the fact that he's been invited to come to the United States doesn't really mean that he comes here because we are trying to lean just totally with the United States. As he has clearly said, multilateral approach to the problems in the region is his way of what he feels is the foreign policy that he has already spelled out.
Okay, now how did this trilateral summit come to be? Who actually called or asked for the summit? Because China's also reacted to Japan and said that Japan should already learn its lessons from history. So how did this trilateral summit come to be, sir?
Well, you know, in fact, I was with the president when he attended the ASEAN meeting in Indonesia, in Jakarta. And during the gala dinner, there was a side meeting between Prime Minister Kishida, President Marcos, and Vice President Kamala Harris. It was actually during that meeting that they were saying that we should try to look for ways and means to cooperate together in finding ways to be able not only to resolve some of the issues surrounding the West Philippine Sea or the South China Sea, but more importantly, a stronger cooperation in the economic sphere. So I suppose that was the takeoff from that. And President Biden, of course, as you know, he's facing an election now. So he decided that perhaps inviting both President Marcos and Prime Minister Kishida to a summit in Washington, D.C. would be a perfect time to do it, especially at this juncture where we have all these challenges.
All right. Now, the Philippines or our Philippine Navy, our Philippine personnel has been experiencing what's been described as gray zone tactics. Some have described it as harassment, bullying, but not enough to actually trigger the Mutual Defense Treaty. What are our expectations from this summit that would actually change what's going on the ground in the West Philippine Sea?
You know, we have, I think our Defense Department has said it on many occasions, that they are doing what we call maximum tolerance or maximum restraint. We are doing everything we can, as the president just said in that clip that you had, that he would like to find ways and means to continue to find a way to be able to have a dialogue with China. The baseline being that we have to recognize the fact that we are protecting merely our territories. The president has said on many occasions that he really is just doing what he is supposed to do to protect the territory of the Philippines. That is his duty. It's a constitutional duty. And so with that comes talking to other friends and allies who work in the same, who are thinking the same way. They respect our territory. At the same time, they are supporting the arbitral award that was given to the Philippines. So it is all based on the freedom of navigation, international law, and the rule of law, and at the same time, the UNCLOS, which was agreed upon. And you know, China is a member of the United Nations Law of the Sea. They are signatory to that.
Okay.
And so we're just merely trying to put together here, recognize this, and then from there, we can talk about other issues.
Now, in terms of this trilateral cooperation, retired Senior Associate Justice Carpio has said that the litmus test is actually the Philippines exploring oil in the Reed Bank. Now, Malaysia's already done their own exploration without having to ask permission from China. And I think it's been a few years, and several observers have said, when will a Philippine president actually do it? Is this part of the discussions in the trilateral summit?
I don't think it will be discussed, but definitely when we're talking about energy, that will be part and parcel of that particular subject on the energy exploration. We have, as you know, we are doing it in Malampaya and The president is very keen on really increasing our energy, our sources of energy, and exploring that, and definitely exploration of those resources in the West Philippine Sea is part and parcel of that plan. Mm. When that will be is, of course, something that we're still looking at. The Department of Energy is in discussion with potential investors and potential partners, together with those that have that concession for that particular exploration. Mm-hmm. But let me also point out, Karen, that the United States has also encouraged many of the nations in the area to get together, precisely to especially the ASEAN countries with overlapping claims, to come out with some kind of a cooperation where we will be able to explore this area for the benefit of the ASEAN region. And we can be ready to talk to even China about this.
Yeah. Actually, what's interesting... I'm sorry to interrupt you, Ambassador. Yes. Please finish.
Well, like I said, we are finding ways and means to be able to use these resources for the benefit of everyone. It's really, and also even protecting the environment. Protecting the environment means protecting everyone else. We know what climate change can do, and that these are the very same things that we have been pointing out to our friends in the region and to China. But so far we have had no response, no All positive. Right.
Now, Ambassador, during the time of former President Duterte, I remember former Foreign Affairs Secretary Alan Cayetano told me on Head Start there was a moratorium on exploration. But the bigger question now, since President Marcos Jr. has gone this far, why isn't exploration his main agenda? That would make a difference in terms of his legacy and walking the talk, right? Why isn't it the main agenda? Because the Constitution allows us to contract a third part for exploration. Why isn't it actually a part of the talks?
Well, it's not yet part of the talks, but I can tell you that precisely we are doing what we're doing right now, getting together with our friends and allies to be able to protect our area. But then together with that, obviously, is to make sure that the areas that we are going to explore, which belongs to us, will have no problem or will have no hindrance or any kind of aggressive behavior coming from other countries. And again, you know, Karen, let me just point out the kind of the wrong way of thinking. For many years, since the early 90s or even before that, we have been we have been patient. We have been accepting most of the things that have been happening in that area. You know, we had people in the Scarborough Shoal. We left, and the Chinese remained there. And our up to this day, our fishermen are not allowed to go into areas where they have been fishing for so many years. Now, what do you expect us to do? Just simply sit around and just simply say, "Go ahead and do this"? We can't. And so President Marcos has made it very clear that he would like to look at our friends and allies to be able to band together and at the same time try to find ways and means to have a dialogue. But we need to have some kind of a muscle, if for lack of any other word, to be able to implement what we have said, that we will protect our territory.
Mm-mm. Now, Ambassador, the United States is the only treaty partner of the Philippines. What are we expecting from Japan in these talks? Of course, strengthening trilateral cooperation, that's the umbrella expectation. But when it comes to the details, what are we hoping for?
Well, Japan and the United States have come out with an agreement now that Japan will be actually manufacturing many of the things that defense equipment. Okay, they're also into shipbuilding. They will be. They have opened up their manufacturing of the ships, perhaps, and so we are going to be part of that arrangement where we will be able to be able to acquire that. Some of them will probably be built in our Subic Bay area, which is also has a shipbuilding facility there. So this cooperation is going to help us modernize not only our armed forces, our Air Force, but also our Navy and our Coast Guard. Mm. All of this, again, let me emphasize, this is all part and parcel of what we are just doing to defend ourselves from any aggression that's coming from other countries.
All right. Okay. Now, what is the reaction of the Philippine government? And I think moving forward, as China has said that it will hold its own drills in response to the Quad exercises in the West Philippine Sea?
Well, as long as they are doing it in the international waters, obviously they can do that. Mm. We have come out with our own cooperation with the other countries, Australia, Japan, and the United States, to be able to do our own drills. And again, all of this is all about the bottom line is we are just out to defend our national interest.
Mm. All right. Now, you have the United States, Australia, President Marcos Jr. is clearly engaging with these countries, but none of these countries are stakeholders. And some have said the United States, another superpower, is in the West, not our neighbor. Are we lacking as a country already in terms of engaging and forming stronger ties really with other stakeholders in the South China Sea issue?
Not at all, Karen. As I said, the president has reached out to our ASEAN neighbors, particularly Vietnam, Indonesia, Malaysia, and Brunei. All are claimants of the same area, are overlapping claims. And we have succeeded, at least at the very least, for them to really seriously look into ways and means to be able to cooperate in protecting the environment.
But then you have some observers, a political analyst once told me that what President Marcos Jr. is doing won't help in the sense that ASEAN is very non-confrontational. So other countries with the same issues against China are handling it quite differently. They've said that this is not the manner in handling China at its best. I'm rephrasing this, of course, Ambassador, but I think you understand. This was an interview with Professor Banlawi. What are your thoughts?
Well, that's also not quite true. If you remember, there was one time, I don't know how long ago this was, but Indonesia actually sunk one of the ships of the Chinese because they were within their waters. Vietnam has also very strongly and courageously fought off many of these incursions that they were doing in their area. We have been very patient. Mm-mm. The Filipino patience has been stretched to the limit. Mm. What President Marcos is doing is just simply saying that enough is enough. We are now going to talk to you seriously. We are not here because we want to have a conflict. We're not here because we just want to have, we're looking for a fight. We are the ones that are being aggressively bullied. And so what are we going to do? The Filipino people will not stand for that. Mm. And I think that's clearly on all the surveys that are coming out, the Filipino people are all behind, not only President Marcos, but behind the country as well.
Mm.
So Ambassador, it can't continue to be like this, Karen. Otherwise, you know, people who have this wrong notion that we'll just sit back and nothing will happen to us, we may wake up one day and we won't have a country anymore.
Mm. You make very interesting points, especially about the behavior of Indonesia and Vietnam at one point. So the Philippines is now pushing back. But is the president ready for the consequences or the repercussions? During the time of the late President Noynoy Aquino, we've seen how China has supposedly, in a way, there have been sanctions when it came to informal sanctions, when it came to our export of bananas, or even the lessening number of Chinese tourists in the country. How is the president going to pivot considering that may happen again?
The president, again, has made the right move. He has reached out not only to the United States, not only to our ASEAN neighbors, or even to Japan in economic security, but he has even gone as far as the European Union. We are going, the president, that is, his policy is economic prosperity means economic security. And that is what he's been doing. Again, people have the wrong notion that he's going gallivanting, traveling all over. The president's tired of traveling, to be honest about it. In fact, he wasn't very keen about coming to Washington again, but he knows how important this trip is. So he has to do what he needs to do to protect ourselves from any future problems that may become a real major problem for us if we don't do anything about it now. And so defense is one of them, but as you mentioned, economic security is very important, and the president is doing exactly that. And because of that, we are obviously getting more investments. People, again, are saying, no, you're not getting anything out of this. That's not absolutely not true. The recent visit, for instance, of a big delegation headed by Commerce Secretary Gina Raimondo of the United States, that is a clear indication that the United States is committed to precisely do what it said it will do, is to not necessarily to help us, but to find ways and means to have a stronger economic cooperation. And that's exactly what we are also doing right now with this trilateral summit that is taking place. Japan is prepared to also come in and invest not only in the Philippines, but to help us in bringing up. They are investing heavily into our infrastructure, the subway system, the ports, many other things that are going to be happening in the next couple of years. And all of this is not going to happen in one swig or one wand, you know, a magic wand. It'll happen successively in the next couple of years. Mm-hmm. And we can expect that. And that is exactly what the president is doing. It may not happen during his time. I mean, the economic prosperity that we're looking at, but we are now planting the seeds and it's going to come out. I'm very confident about that. And many people are also. In fact, I was just talking to Secretary Recto. He sees that there will be the economic growth in the Philippines will be about 6.5% with foreign investments coming in successively in the next couple of years, all the way up to 2028 when the president terms ends.
All right. Before we end, I wanted to ask you and follow up on the trade mission, of course, more than the trade mission. I believe it was billions of dollars, right, in investments in the Philippines. But the president's previous visits, I know that he either formed a committee or a group to actually follow up on these promises to make sure that they come into fruition. What's happened with that, Ambassador?
Well, we have now Frederick Goh, who is now the presidential assistant, precisely to follow up on all these investments. And I think the Secretary Goh is at one point in time. Right now, he's still working hard on it. In fact, he won't be able to come to Washington, D.C., although we encourage him to do so. But he's quite busy precisely putting together all of these things. And before, I would assume that before the president speaks in July for his State of the Nation address, you can expect him to report on what are these major investments that have come into the Philippines and what we can expect in the future. Right now, Karen, to be honest about it, I'm hearing something like $100 billion. I mean, that's quite a large amount of money that is being considered for investments into the Philippines and the Philippine economy in the next 5 to 10 years. Now, all of that is because we are now going out of our way to make sure that the Philippines is ready, it is a secure place to invest, and having these relationships with like-minded countries, including the European Union, where they're very supportive of all of the Philippines, is now looking into investing in this in our part of the world. And the Philippines happens to be in the center of Asia. You know, former President Trump said that the most expensive real estate in Asia is the Philippines, because we are right in the center.
On that note, I want to thank you so much for joining me today, and good luck with the trilateral summit, sir. We'd love to hear from you again. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you, Karen, and I hope that this will be successful for all of us. Thank you.
Philippine Ambassador to the United States, Jose Manuel Romualdez. We're going to take a quick break. Head Start will be right back. Head Start. Let's continue our discussion on the maritime tensions in the West Philippine Sea. We're now joined by Philippine Coast Guard spokesperson for the West Philippine Sea, Commodore J. Tariela. Commodore Tariela, good morning to you.
Good morning, Ms. Karen, and also to your viewers.
All right. The trilateral summit in the United States, or with the United States in Japan, comes right after we've conducted our own drills, right? With the U.S., Japan, and Australia. Let's talk about the effect of such drills. You've heard already a scathing response from China regarding this.
Well, Ms. Karen, no? I think it's very important for us to note that even without this kind of activities we had with the United States or any other like-minded countries, the level of tension and provocation of the Chinese has always been the same. They would still harass our Filipino fishermen. Their supply operation will always be hampered by their Coast Guard vessels, and they're still going to carry out dangerous maneuver towards the Philippine Coast Guard vessels. So I think, with or without this kind of activities that we're doing, Chinese has always been increasing the tension. But the other good side of it is that it's not just the Philippines who is contesting or criticizing these illegal actions of China. And it's not just, we're not just limited with our traditional allies. Since we started this transparency strategy, more countries are standing up, more countries are extending security cooperation with the armed forces of the Philippines, and willing to have this kind of activity in the West Philippine Sea.
All right. I'm curious. You did mention that, I believe, just recently, three PLA, right, vessels were discovered or were sent. Can you expound on that in terms of the circumstances surrounding it? Because that is the latest.
Well, I'm not really sure as to when are you referring, Ms. Karen, but there are a lot of PLA sightings that we already did. Like, for example, with the last resupply mission, we were able to monitor as many as four or five PLA Navy vessels. And then this time, during the bio laying, the floating aggregate device that we drop in Rizal Reef, we also monitor the PLA Navy vessel. So there are sightings already of the People's Liberation Army Navy warship, but all of these warships are not directly engaging the Philippine Coast Guard or even the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources. They are still just a bit afar from our operation, but of course we can monitor them too later.
Okay. Commodore, I'm curious. It's important to measure things to know if there's an improvement or if we are in a situation that's actually getting worse. Compared to the administration of former President Duterte to today, where President Marcos Jr. has a different foreign policy, right, compared to his predecessor, would you say there are more Chinese vessels in the West Philippine Sea or less?
Well, first of all, Ms. Karen, I think we should also understand before we highlight the number of the vessels of the Chinese being deployed in the West Philippine Sea, that this kind of harassment has also been happening during the time of President Duterte. The only reason why we're not talking about it, it's because we didn't choose to publicize it.
That's true.
The public, the media outlets are not telling the public about it because we choose to be silent about it. So in terms of those kind of activities and illegal presence of China, this has been happening even during the time of President Duterte. But going back to your question, are there more vessels now compared with the number of vessels that Chinese vessels that are deployed in President Duterte's time? We can fairly say there is an increase. But again, this is in relation with our response of transparency, telling the world about their kind of harassment. But in general, still, you know, the level of provocation of China remains to be the same. The only difference that they don't need to send more vessels, because in the first place, we have already folded. We have already told the Filipino people that we cannot do anything about it. So, you know, if they're going to send like two Coast Guard vessels or one PLA Navy vessel, they have already attained their objective. But for our president now, who chooses to publicize and expose this kind of illegal actions, they need to flex more muscle for them to threaten us. And that's the reason and the explanation why China has more vessel deployment now in the West Philippine Sea compared with the previous administration.
Okay. All right. It's quite interesting. Now, let's get into detail. Attorney Harry Roque was on Head Start and he criticized what he described as the microphone diplomacy of this administration. So I wanted to ask you specifically with Ayung Inshol, for example, there was a lot of talk of Ayung Inshol in terms of rehabilitating the BRP Sierra Madre, right?
Mm-hmm.
What is the status of the BRP Sierra Madre today, right now? When was our last resupply mission and when will the next be?
Well, the last respond to your earlier question, you know, the last resupply mission is March 23. And as to the next resupply mission, it still depends on the Armed Forces of the Philippines whenever they're going to conduct that. And since the Coast Guard is just supporting this military operation in BRP Sierra Madre. But let me go back to the comment of Attorney Harry Roque. People like Attorney Harry Roque and some of the Chinese trolls online has always been blaming this, what they call microphone diplomacy. But as far as the national government is concerned, this is not a microphone diplomacy. This is an information strategy that we choose to expose the factual narrative of what's happening. They are claiming that this kind of strategy provokes China and escalates attention. But that's not the way it is. The mere fact that more countries now are standing up and supporting the Philippines and more Filipino people are also supportive of our approach, that's the very objective of this strategy. Not to provoke anybody and not to escalate the tension.
I'm curious, within the area of BRP Sierra Madre, is the Philippine Coast Guard constantly patrolling the area or do we have a vessel on standby near the BRP Sierra Madre?
Well, Ms. Karen, to be honest about it, the Philippine Coast Guard at any one time has three Coast Guard vessels deployed in Palawan and it patrols the entire vast sea area of the West Philippine Sea.
Yeah. Clearly, that's not enough, right?
Clearly, that's not enough.
That's not enough. Yeah.
Yes. But of course, we have our own way to monitor them. We have, the Canadian government has been very nice to support us with the dark vessel detection. And of course, our other allies has also supported us satellite imagery of what's really happening in different parts of our West Philippine Sea. So we can fairly monitor whatever is happening in the deployment of the PLA Navy or even the Chinese Coast Guard, the Chinese Maritime Militia, where are the areas that they are swarming? Those kind of information at real time, our national government is pretty much aware, even if we have a very limited number of Coast Guard vessels deployed in Palawan.
I'm curious, Commodore, would you have any information if during Duterte's time there was any rehabilitation of BRP Sierra Madre? Because this was part of the discussion that we had with Attorney Harry Roque. He said, rehabilitate by all means, but don't announce it or do it in another way.
That's a very delicate question, Ms. Karen. We should ask them, right? I mean, the rehabilitation has been an issue by the Chinese, has also been raised by Attorney Harry Roque as one of the provocative reason why China has been giving us headache in doing this resupply operation. But as far as the national government is concerned under this administration, as what has been mentioned by ADG Jonathan Malaya, regardless, whatever we bring to BRP Sierra Madre, whether these are just food, whether these are just personnel for rotation, we should not care about what they feel. This Ayung Inshol on board BRP Sierra Madre falls within our exclusive economic zone. So this is not a concern for the national government as to whatever comments that they're going to criticize us that we're bringing in construction materials. It's beside the point. We have sovereign rights over these waters. Regarding their comment, we don't really care.
All right. We don't really care. All right. That's interesting coming from you, the Philippine Coast Guard Commodore. Another question is Scarborough Shoal. What is the status today? There's been a lot of talk on Scarborough Shoal, especially with my interviews with former Senator Antonio Trillanes and the commentary of did we leave, did we stay, did we leave, did we lose Scarborough Shoal? You know, that phrase, we lost Scarborough Shoal, has, well, number one, former Senator Antonio Trillanes actually disagrees with that statement completely, right? So let's go on to what is the status of Scarborough Shoal today?
Well, Ms. Karen, let me first strengthen this, the statement of Ambassador Waldez this morning during his interview. He mentioned that in Scarborough Shoal, our arrangement is that both parties during the standoff will pull out. You know, the Philippine forces, to include the Coast Guard, the Navy, the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources, in 2012, we pulled out. But the Chinese forces, they stayed there. And now there are still Chinese Coast Guard vessels inside Bajo de Masinlo or Scarborough.
Inside Scarborough?
Inside the Scarborough.
How many? Would you know how many?
There is, you know, I responded this already to my previous interviews. There were always like two Chinese Coast Guard vessels mainstay inside Scarborough Shoal. These are the two Chinese Coast Guard vessels who have the responsibility in laying out the floating barrier every time that they monitor a presence of the Philippine government vessel there. But let me give you a clear background now of what's happening now in Scarborough Shoal. During the time of the former administration, we have already folded with the idea that, you know, we don't need to go near Bajo de Masinlo. As far as the Philippine Coast Guard is concerned and the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources is concerned, we don't really get near PDM. As a matter of fact, we always maintain like 10 nautical miles to 12 nautical miles in patrolling those areas. In short, we have already, you know, at some point recognized that we don't have the ability to go beyond the 10 nautical mile, 12 nautical mile of the Chinese Coast Guard who's in that area. Yeah. But for this administration, for President Bongbong Marcos, we keep on, going beyond the 12 nautical mile mark, 10 nautical mile mark, until we reach as low as 500 meters away from the lagoon already. Meaning, for this administration, for President Bongbong Marcos, the Philippine Coast Guard and the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources, we can already go to Bajo de Masinlo as near as 500, 300 meters. We are no longer prevented from going beyond that. But to be honest with you, the only problem that we are now experiencing whenever we patrol Bajo de Masinlo is that we cannot really go inside the lagoon. It's very difficult.
Why not? What happens when we try?
Well, first of all, Ms. Karen, you know for a fact that we already removed the barrier by a covert operation, you know, a special operation of the Philippine Coast Guard during the last year, right? But the problem now is that at any one time, every time that the Philippine Coast Guard or the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources will be supporting our fishermen with, you know, supplies, fuel, there will be additional supplement from the Chinese Coast Guard. So from 2, it will be like 5. And then Chinese Maritime Militia will also be there from 8 to even 12 Chinese Maritime Militia. And then they would start blocking this small opening of the lagoon in Bajo de Masinlo. That's the only reason why we are prevented in entering the lagoon.
Okay. My last question on this is the relevance to the Filipino people. What are the two Chinese vessels inside Bajo de Masinlo doing? Okay, is it actually setting the stage for fishing in Bajo de Masinlo? are the Chinese fishing in Scarborough Shoal and the Philippines cannot? Because I remember during the time of former President Duterte, his cabinet members would always say, because of the peace within the area, is Filipino fishermen were allowed to fish outside the opening of the shoal. What is really going on inside Scarborough?
Well, we have released satellite imagery. The only vessel that you can find inside the lagoon are just the two Chinese Coast Guard vessels guarding inside the lagoon. But for the Filipino fishermen, we have already interviewed...
But are the two Chinese vessels fishing? Or you're talking about really just actually guarding the area?
Yes. They are just there guarding the area, preventing the Philippine government from entering the lagoon and also the Filipino fishermen as well.
Yes. And I think a reminder to all the viewers is with the arbitral decision, Scarborough Shoal was actually deemed as a common fishing ground, right?
Yes. As decided by the arbitral award.
Yes. So technically, all countries that fish in the area can actually have the right to fish in Scarborough Shoal. But is it right to say no other country does as well? Does Vietnam fish in Scarborough?
Not all countries, Ms. Karen, just three countries, Vietnam, Philippines, and China, based on the arbitral award, recognize this as a traditional fishing ground.
And does Vietnam fish in Scarborough today?
Not that we have monitored.
I see. All right. Well, on that note, anything you'd like to say, Commodore, before we end?
Well, on the part of the Philippine Coast Guard, as under the leadership of our Commandant, Admiral Ron Hill Gavan, we're still going to support the Armed Forces of the Philippines and, of course, the objective of our presence for food security. You know, Ms. Karen, just last week, we supported the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources in dropping floating aggregate device in Rosol Reef. With a very limited number of the vessels that we have in the West Philippine Sea, the Filipino people can still rely on the Philippine Coast Guard. We're not going to be deterred. We're not going to yield, as what the President has mentioned. Our presence in the Philippine Coast Guard, in the West Philippine Sea, the Philippine Coast Guard can assure the Filipino people that despite of the provocation and the illegal action of the Chinese Coast Guard, we're still going to deal with them professionally, and we're not going to be the reason of escalation.
On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today, Commodore Jay Tariela of the Philippine Coast Guard. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Ms. Karen.
And that's Get Start Today, everybody. I'm Karen Davila. Thank you for watching. You can play back this episode on the ANC YouTube channel. Stay informed and stay with ANC.
Relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more.